try, but we try too hard. It's a waste of my time to looking for the critics, cause they're everywhere. They don't like my jeans, they don't get my hair. Strange as cells, and we do it all the time. Why do we do that? Why do I do that? Why do I do that? Yeah!
A little song I wrote back in 2010 when I was in San Jose, California, far away from home, wondering if I would ever be ordained or ever have a church. God, you give strength for my journey. You know how weary I am. You comfort my spirit. Your presence, I feel it. So lead me down the right path. For you know the journey behind me, and you know the journey ahead. Teach me to trust in your wisdom as you love me just as I am.
Come to me, my child.
child, and I will give you rest. Come to me, my child. May it be so. Good morning. Rise in spirit and stand as you're able as we sing together more.
There's a Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know they feel the presence of the Lord. Sweet
pretty good, but when we sing it in a minute, I want us to sing it like we feel it. Without a doubt, we'll know and have smiles on our faces as we sing it. But we can start by smiling, by looking to your neighbor, shaking their hand, hugging their neck. Tell them you're glad you're here. We have several visitors this morning. Let's welcome them. Together.
There are blessings we shall all receive when we know the Spirit's fullness and believe. We're the ones to profit when we say,
tell you what, I'm liking this thing, having an associate minister. You know, I was scheduled to be in Washington and actually had non-refundable tickets to the inauguration. But on November 9th, I thought, not so much. We were still planning to go to the Washington Women's March, though, and then I was so honored. Brandy Lee is part of the organizing committee for that fabulous march in Lexington yesterday. Brandy, thank you and your committee for a job well done. And so they were looking for speakers, and she said, I think my pastor will speak, and I was so honored to do it. So Brent and I decided we'd just stay in hometown. But I posted on our Facebook this morning, we were well represented. We had five of our members in Washington, Sandy and Cindy, Carol and Michelle, and Emmy were all there. And we had a boatload of us down there yesterday. So what a great day it was. And listen, on Friday, we also had a really, really special service here. I want to thank all of those who came early. I know Kenny and Jeremy were here at 6 in the morning, and Dean locked up, and James stayed for a few hours to keep things going. Others were here, and we had a very, very special prayer service at 12:15, and appreciative for that. You're going to see flags sitting around in your chair backs, and you see some that are up here. This morning, if you are so moved to write a prayer for our country, we invite you to do that even during the sermon, the service, maybe during a song or during communion. If you would like to write something, there's some pens scattered around too, and just bring it up during communion time, we invite you to do that, because I'm going to take those flags, Kenny and I, and look at them and implement that in our prayers in the upcoming weeks. It's good to see you this morning. A few announcements. Teenagers are meeting on Saturday at noon, and that will be a focus on prayer. So if you are a teenager or want to be one, come join them. There's going to have some fried chicken. You can't pray without fried chicken. So we're going to have that. And that's going to be more important in something they're going to see later about frying chicken.
That'll make you want to be a teenager.
It will. That's right. That's right. Next Sunday's a very special service. We're going to give thanks to our 2016 elders and council and trustees. And then we're going to install our new council and elders and trustees. And we also are going to install our new associate minister, Kenny Bishop. So it's going to be a special Sunday worship next week. You want to miss that. And we have NOSH, No One Stays Hungry. That's been going very well. If you need some soup, your week looks like it's, you know, you have some medical stuff coming on, or things at home are a little tight and you just need a little soup to sort of carry you over to the following week, we've got it in the kitchen and we've got containers. We invite you to get that. Kenny, what else is coming up?
Well, a week from today is Fifth Sunday, and as folks who are regulars around here know, we do special things on Fifth Sundays. There are about four of them every year, a month that has a Fifth Sunday, and that's next Sunday night at 6 o'clock. Justin Ryan is going to be with us. We've been sharing some of his music before the services each Sunday morning, and I talked with Justin this week, and he said, hey, let them know I do Pink. So, I thought the video this morning explained that very well. But I think everybody's going to really enjoy hearing Justin. He has an incredible story and just a beautiful, sweet, gentle spirit, and one of those people who loves to laugh. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later on. So, help us spread the word, get the word out, and be with us next Sunday night at 6 o'clock to hear Justin Ryan in concert.
You won't want to miss it. What about we sing that last chorus again? Can we do that with smiles? Sweet Holy Spirit, there we go. Sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place.
Please join us in our call to worship. When time and circumstance have taken our smile,
help us remember that you are our smile.
when events and worry have robbed us of joy.
Help us remember that you are our joy.
When laughter and hilarity have lost their appeal,
help us remember that it is you who makes us to laugh.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we have gathered here this morning to worship your holy name. We come to this place to receive comfort from the week past. We find that comfort from you and from the love we feel from these individuals around us. We also come to this place to gain strength for the week ahead, for we need that strength to carry out your work in your world. Thank you for this church, this safe place for us to worship, and for these leaders that guide us this morning. Help us to receive your words of comfort and strength. In God's holy name, amen.
Amen. Rise in spirit and stand as you are able. We're going to sing number 4 in a black hymnal, or it's on the screen. Joyful, joyful, we adore you.
Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, God of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the storms of doubt. Fill us with the light of day. All your works with joy surround you. Earth and heaven reflect your rays. Stars and angels sing around you. Center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, teach us what our praise should be. You are giving and forgiving, wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest, loving spirit, father, mother, all who love belong to you. Teach us how to love each other by joy renew. Mortals join the mighty chorus which the morning stars began. Boundless love is reigning o'er us, reconciling race and clan. Ever singing, move we forward, faithful in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life.
May be seated.
Wow. You know, when you're up here, and of course Pastor Marsha is learning this now as she does worship this morning, you get to see, well, you know this anyway, you get to see a lot and hear a lot, and not only hear the songs and hear the voices, but see the faces, and that always brings lots and lots of joy to me. One of these days we need to get on this screen, we need to get a camera right here, just kind of shooting down that way, and everybody can watch their, no, that's not a good idea. You can tell that was off the fly.
You know, I asked John if he could cut his mic off and turn mine on if he got out of control.
She's a little worried about my Pentecostal history. We have a lot to be joyful about this morning. We have a lot to be grateful for, a lot to be happy about, a lot to laugh about. We have a lot to be concerned about and a lot to pray for. Some of us have had beautiful weeks and some of us have had trying times and trying weeks. And this is a moment in the service where we share those with our congregation so we can all join you in that rejoicing and in that prayer. So who might have a joy or a concern that you'd like to share with the congregation this morning? Stanley?
Besides my usual request, we've got at work a lady named Christina, and she has a 1-year-old named Ella, and she has been diagnosed with cancer as of the 8th day of January. And so the second day of February, from 11 in the morning to 4 in the morning, we're going to have a cookout, and we're going to try to raise money to help offset the cost on that. So I'll mention it again next week, and I really appreciate it if I can see a few of y'all come out and help us.
Certainly. Thank you, Stanley, for sharing that.
Then my usual A-ball and my family, the people at Kroger. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Stanley. Who else? Jeff.
I just got a text message from a friend of mine back home in Arvin. They found a spot on his lot, and they're going through the diagnosis process right now, so she has to
Absolutely. We certainly will. Who else?
I would like to mention a couple things. First, I'd like us to pray for Kenny's son-in-law and daughter and family. Kenny's son-in-law's business burned on Friday night, and you can share more about that, Kenny.
Sure. They, my son-in-law and daughter are run and operate a construction business, and of course all of his equipment and tools and everything were in the building that burned. Some of it's salvageable, but they've lost quite a bit, so we do appreciate your prayers.
And then I would like us to remember Peggy Aglehart, who got some not-so-good news on her PET scan this week, and she will be starting her third round of chemo here in the next week. And so we want to lift up Peggy and Belinda in these really trying times for them. And also want to remember my sister-in-law, Tricia, who has her sixth and final chemo treatment this week, and prayers for she and George in Seattle.
Absolutely. Certainly. Who else? Mm-hmm.
I guess just some prayers for one of my good friends, Charlie. We're veterans together, and he had a diagnosis of lymphoma cancer. And I don't know if anybody knows anything about the VA, but sometimes they take a little bit longer than usual. So just some prayers for him, and as well some prayers for my mother. She's really just not doing so well. So Charlie and my mother, Patricia.
Absolutely.
I want to add some attention. I am really and mostly emotional about yesterday because a lot of us are out there to support women's rights and everything else. I also want to share that my nephew will be here pretty soon, and we're still looking for a place, so if anyone has in mind, a place that we can rent. Appreciate it.
Certainly.
Continued prayers for everyone facing addiction, whether it be drugs, alcohol, or whatever it may be. You know, because it's just something that's ongoing. We've got a real, real bad problem, not just in Lexington, but all the United States, which it's terrible.
It is.
Continued prayer.
Absolutely. Brandy.
I have two joys. One, I finally started my new job. And two, the march yesterday went a lot better than they had planned. They were hoping for at least 1,000. I had like 6,000.
Fantastic. Who else? In the back.
She wasn't wearing her seatbelt. The airbag didn't at the point. And she has a fractured hip, two blood clots, double pneumonia, bruised sternum. But in the novel x-rays, they found nodules on her lungs, masses on her thyroid, unrelated to the accident. And so she's got to go back for more testing. And she's just having a really hard time. And just praying that everything comes out of the
Absolutely. What's your mother's name? What's your mother's name?
Brenda.
Brenda, thank you. Certainly. Who else? Mm-hmm. In the back.
They asked the church to give praise to Roy Martin and Bobby Martin, their granddaughter, great-granddaughter's in the hospital, and they don't know what the problem is, but she has been there for a week, isolated. You have to wear a mask and everything, and so they can't go. And they're saying that they don't know what the problem is. Roy and Mark, they just don't know, because their daughter just trying to be hush-hush about what's going on. But so regardless, it is like my husband and I are giving them comfort, because they come to our house. They were there yesterday, and and I also want to thank the church, the ones at the church, and everybody that was downtown yesterday. I was one of those too, and it was just so fabulous. And I want to say to the minister, I give her, you know, thanks for what she did say about. It was just with pride.
Absolutely.
You know, girlfriend, boy, you know, or anything. Wife. I mean, it was such loud pride.
It was a great day. It was a great day. Thank you very much. Joe.
I am just grateful to be here this morning and very, very appreciative, and just love my church family despite being estranged for a few months. I walk in and open arms, just like I was. Never left. And I love everyone. Everyone's great. I missed everyone. And just send up a little prayer. Nikki turned 16, so she's going to be grabbing.
Oh, Jesus.
Mom is a little freaked out.
You wait till I tell Jesus Nikki's driving.
I'm just glad to be here. Glad to see you.
We're glad to see you too. Always. Anyone else? Let's prepare our hearts for prayer.
There's a spirit. There's a spirit of love in this place. Oh, alleluia. Sing alleluia. We bless your
We come to you now, pausing, taking a moment to say thank you. We thank you for every good thing that we know, because we believe that you are the provider of good things. We thank you for experiences, and we thank you for joy. We thank you for happiness. And God, as hard as it is sometimes. We even thank you for our sorrows, the ones that mold us, make us, and encourage us to rely on you. And this morning, we've heard lots of joys and lots of things to be thankful for. But we've also heard about those concerns. We've heard cancer and lymphoma from those who were way, way, way too young to have to deal with such things. We've heard about phone calls in the night and the terror that it brings. God, we trust you with all of these things. I pray right now for Ella and Jeff's friend. We continue to pray for Peggy. The unhappy news that she received this week, but we pray for her and for Belinda, who continues to stand and stay with her. It's Tricia and Charlie. Patricia. Bob reminded us this morning that there are so many who are facing that daily struggle and that daily temptation with a chemical that binds them and holds them. God, we pray that you would be very evident in that moment in their life. And when they have to make the decision, if there's a way, somehow if there's a way that it could be interfered with, God, we trust you. We thank you for Brandy's new job. And God, we're worried about Brenda and the car accident and all of those things. Roy Martin's granddaughter, and although we may not know what's going on, we trust you there. God, we're grateful that Joe was with us this morning. God, all of us who've had that moment where we look that child that we love in the eye and they ask us to trust them behind the wheel of a car. God, we know it's not a light thing, so we trust you. And God, we trust you with this day. We trust you with our nation and with our state, with our city, our neighborhood, and our church. We trust you, God. And that's why we pause to call on you and to bring these things to you. We ask you to take them, and we ask you to be with us through the remainder of this worship service today. We pray, we believe, and we ask in your name. Amen.
There's a presence of peace in this room. There's a presence of peace in this room. And God's tenderness is found.
Peace at last.
Children, please. Come on. There they come.
Jesus loves
the morning. Come on.
Children,
Daniel,
all the children of the world, rich and young, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Did I have a good week? It's a pretty good week. I learned some stuff. Who is this? That's Tigger. Does anybody remember Elmo? Raise your hand if you remember Elmo. Does anybody have a toy called a Tickle Me Elmo? There's people with them. Tell us what Elmo does. When you tickle Elmo, what does he do? He giggles. Does he just do it sometimes when you're happy? Or does he do it every single time? What happens if somebody tickles you? Are you ticklish? Are you ticklish? Carson, I know you're ticklish.
Come here.
We laugh. Why do you think God made up laughter? Does it do anything? Does it, it makes you happy. That's right. What if you're sad and you laugh anyway? What does that do? Does it still make you happy, Maya? Yes. It does. It doesn't serve any other purpose but to make us happy. That's a great gift from God, isn't it? A lot of people were feeling sad this week. It's been a hard week, and I don't think many people laughed. Did you laugh, Willow? Good for you. I want us to think about every time we laugh, what a good gift that is from God. And what a funny gift. How do you think God thought that up? You think maybe God was laughing one day and said, well, this is fun. This makes me happy. What things make you laugh besides tickling? Have you ever heard a funny joke? Don't worry, I'm not going to tell one. She can't? Well. Sometimes when somebody comes up and hugs me I haven't seen for a long time, that makes me laugh because it makes me happy. So let's say a prayer thanking God for laughter. Dear God, thank you for helping us laugh.
Thank you for helping us laugh.
It's such a great gift.
Such a great gift.
Help us to thank you for it.
Help us to thank you for it.
And help us to share laughter with other people.
Help us to share laughter with other people.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, guys. Have fun in children's church.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah 9:1-4. And there will be no more gloom for her who was in anguish. In earlier times, he treated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali with contempt. But later on, he shall make it glorious by the way of the sea on the other side of Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who walk in darkness will see light. Those who live in the dark land, the light will shine on them. You shall multiply the nation. You shall increase their gladness. They will be glad in your presence, as with the gladness of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you shall break the yoke of their burden and the staff on their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, as at the battle of Midian.
Now let us pause for a profound and poignant theological exposition presented by Mark Lowry.
Hey! Are y'all having a good time at the Dove Awards tonight? Are you ready for some good news? Dogs go to heaven. It's in the Bible. Psalm 36:6. Read it when you get home. Dogs go to heaven. Any dog lovers here? Yeah, I mean, it's in the, we should have known he's coming back on a white horse. There are animals there. The lion will lay down with the lamb. There are animals there. Now, cats go to hell, but I can't help that. I can't help it. I didn't write the Bible. No, I think all animals go to heaven. I really do. Read the scripture, Psalm 36:6. I think there, every chicken you ever ate is going to be waiting on you. And I think cats and dogs will all be there. You know, you can't go through eternity without Fluffy. And I just think they're different denominations. I think dogs are Pentecostal. You know, their tongue's always out. They're wagging. They're happy to be there. Shaking their tail. It's a fun group of people, and they're happy to see you. I was raised Baptist. We weren't happy about much. I was raised independent, fundamental, Bible-believing, Bible-banging, foot-stomping, soul-winning, door-knocking, pew-jumping, devil-chasing, sin-hating, King James Version only Baptist. And I'm happy about it. Our preachers weren't always right, but they were never in doubt. And all of them were fat. We're not allowed to. I mean, you never heard one of our preachers preach on gluttony. No, sir. We want to give the Lord a challenge in the rapture. But I'm telling you, your dog will be there. I mean, when you step on your dog's foot, what does it do? It yelps. And you breaks your heart. And you get down there and say, Fluffy, I'm so sorry. And what is she doing? She's licking your foot. That's a Christian. Try that with your wife. I can prove to you. Who's got a wife and a dog? Anybody here got a wife and a dog? I'm telling you, Jason, your wife loves you. Your dog loves you more than your wife. Your dog loves you more than your wife. I can prove it. Take your wife and your dog home tonight. Put them in the trunk of your car. Come back in 1 hour. Open that trunk and see who's glad to see you. It won't be the little woman. It'll be the Christian.
Well, some of the theology might be up for a bit of debate, but Mark Lowry's always good for a bit of practical Bible study.
By the way, for those of you who are wondering, Psalm 36:6 says, your righteousness is like the strongest mountains. Your justice is like the deepest sea. Lord, you save both humans and animals. So, maybe Mark's right. Maybe dogs and cats do go to heaven. That's the sort of thing that makes us smile, makes us laugh. I love to be around people who make me laugh. I love to make people laugh. I never met my grandpa Bishop, but I hear he was that kind of person. He passed away a couple of years before I was born. But I've certainly heard lots and lots of stories about the kind of fun-loving, happy person that George Bishop was. When he was a kid, one time he held a week-long revival in a little African-American church right down the street from where he lived. Now, he wasn't a preacher. But he just happened to wander into this church one Sunday morning and went to the service there and really enjoyed it. And so after the service, he went up to the pastor and he said, by the way, I'm a preacher. The pastor, without asking any questions and trusting him completely, said, well, then why don't you come hold us a few nights of revival? So my young teenage grandpa did just that. He went to the service starting on Sunday night and held about a week's worth of revival services. And every night the crowd got a little bigger and a little bigger and a little bigger. He was feeling really good about himself. Now remember, he wasn't a preacher. Now let's remember too that in a lot of the tradition that I grew up in, you didn't have to have much to be a preacher. You didn't have to have any credentials or ordination or any sort of education or anything like that. You could just claim to be a preacher, and a lot of people just trusted that you were a preacher, sort of like Marsha's doing right now. Revival services were going really, really well. The little church just by the, I guess the later on in the week, they said the place was just absolutely packed with people who were hearing stories about this young, dynamic preacher who was coming in and preaching in the black church down the street. And as a matter of fact, apparently his mother got wind of it. And without even knowing it was him, she decided to go to that church one night for the revival service. The place was filling up, and there was my grandpa, George Bishop, standing on the platform just like this when he saw his mama walk in. He started looking around, wondering where they'd like to put a back door. And he escaped, and revival ended that night. But that was the kind of person he was. He lived free, and he loved to make people laugh. There's another story about one time. Some of you will remember that it used to be pretty common that older men would hang around the courthouse. They'd come in from out in the county or around the city, and they'd come and they'd sit around the courthouse, and they'd tell tall tales, and they would whittle sticks. And it used to be a pretty common thing around a lot of courthouses around the country. And one afternoon, my grandpa and some of his friends were sitting around the courthouse in Richmond, and Governor King Johnson happened to walk up. He looked down at my grandpa and asked him about his pocket knife, and he said, "Is that a sharp knife?" Without speaking a word, my grandpa just took his knife, reached up, pulled the governor's tie, and right below the knot, he cut it off. Governor said, "I reckon it is." Sat down and had a big laugh about it. I'd like to encourage you not to get that close to a governor's throat with a knife, especially these days. Everybody called my grandpa, his name was George, but everybody called him Happy. Some people never even knew his real name. They only knew him. They had always known him as Happy. And as far as they knew, that was his real name. That's all they knew him by. It was even on his gravestone, as a matter of fact. Seriously, take a look. That's how I'd like to be remembered. I'd like to be known a little bit like that, as someone who is so happy, someone who's always ready to encourage a smile and make a reason to laugh. Have you ever noticed how contagious it can be?
Your day.
Yeah, you did.
I wish you could have seen your faces. I don't know what you were thinking of before the video started to roll, but it seemed like it backed up a little bit. I saw smiles. Some of them were really, really big, toothy ones. I love those. I saw grins. I heard some of you laugh. We really could use a little more laughter nowadays. It feels good to laugh. It makes us feel good when we see and hear other people laugh. It's good for our minds, and it's good for our bodies. And psychologically and physiologically, studies have shown, research has said, that we change physiologically when we laugh. We stretch muscles all throughout our body and our face. Our pulse and our blood pressure goes up. We breathe faster, and we send more oxygen to our tissues. People who believe in the benefits of laughter say that it can be like a mild workout. Laughing offers some of the same advantages as a workout, and it's a great way to boost your heart rate. It burns calories. Yeah. A study at Vanderbilt University showed that 10 to 15 minutes of laughter burns about 50 calories. But keep in mind, before you go tossing out your workout clothes and canceling your gym membership, that a piece of chocolate also has about 50 calories. And at the rate of about 50 calories an hour, losing 1 pound would require about 12 straight hours of really good laughing. So if you eat a lot of chocolate, you need to do a lot of laughing. But the scripture also says in Proverbs 17, and we've all heard this over and over again, that laughter really is the best medicine. And then it goes on to say that a cheerful mind works healing. And then it goes further and says that a broken spirit dries up the bones. So let's be real. We all know, and some of us know all too well, that every day doesn't give us reason to laugh. Every day is not sunny. And not everything is worthy of a smile or laughter. There were some people who were delighted with the events of this past week. They celebrated that the person they felt best represents their interests, their ideals, their values now sits in the White House. For them, it was a real reason to celebrate. The result of the presidential election made them happy. But for others, not so much. It's always that way at the end of an election and a ball game. There are always winners and losers. Some of us took the events of this past week very personally. We took it personally because this wasn't a ball game. This is our life. It's our safety. It's our place in the world. So, the delight for those who felt disenfranchised by the events of Friday came in the form of gathering and marching and speaking up on Saturday. Millions of women and supporters of fairness and equality, not just here in the U.S., but around the world, stood up and stepped out to be seen and heard and felt. And the last numbers I saw were, I think there were over 600 rallies around the world, pushing upwards of 3 million people, the last count. And we had over 5,000, nearly 6,000 here in Lexington yesterday. And because we here at BUCC believe in justice and equality and fairness, our own pastor was a prominent voice at yesterday's rally. We're proud. We're proud. We're proud of our commitment. We're proud of our commitment for speaking up and being a voice for what we believe is right in such a time as this. During the march and the rally that preceded it, there were chants among the people and songs and speeches and, yes, laughter. There was delight that we live in a country and a place where we can gather and make protest and be heard. Where there is delight, there is laughter, and even in the midst of protest. But sometimes, in the worst of circumstances, the best thing we can possibly do is laugh. All right.
Hi.
What's your name?
Cameron.
Hi, Cameron. I'm Patch.
Red.
Oh, it is.
It's red.
What's that?
You don't know.
I don't either.
Let's find out.
Take a sec.
Try on you.
It's working for you. Sit up.
Yeah, sometimes in the worst of circumstances, the best thing we can do is laugh. Bruce Valanche is a really funny guy. Some of you may remember when he was with us here in Lexington and headlined a Fairness Awards event a few years back. Besides being a stand-up comedian, he's also a writer, and one of his big gigs is he writes for a lot of the television award shows. He writes for pretty much all of them, the Oscars and the Tonys, the Grammys and the Emmys. He says that it's kind of tricky because when you're writing for those shows, you have to consider that as the night goes along, the room starts filling with losers. Really? I mean, think about it. For every one person who wins, four lose. And he says, you always have to consider that, and it makes for a really hard laugh when you're the loser. Today in our scripture, we find ourselves somewhere in the middle of a long and tragic story of an ancient, divided Hebrew people that pretty much felt like losers. They were one people literally divided in two separate nations. Sometimes we feel like our country is one of those very divided nations. L.Z. Granderson, some of you may be familiar with him. He's a good friend of mine, and he's a regular political consultant on CNN, and he's also a sports broadcaster on ESPN. Yesterday, he mentioned on his Facebook page that he was having a conversation with a friend, and his friend said, L.Z., I think this is the most divided our nation has ever been. And L.Z. said, have you ever heard of the Civil War? As bad as it is, it's been worse. But in today's scripture, we find the nation of Israel literally divided in half, separated by a border. And for over 200 years, brothers and sisters simply could not get along. But the word we hear today from Isaiah the prophet is cause for at least a smile, because he's prophesying about a change. The people who walked in darkness, he said, have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. And as the scripture continues beyond what Cindy read to us today, Isaiah tells of a person who will come and bring good news. He says, speaking forward, Jesus, that he will come and bring good news for the outcast, good news for the forgotten, good news for the marginalized, good news for the desperate, good news for the minority, good news for those who find themselves surrounded by bad news. When you've been the victim on the bottom of the pile or at the back of the bus or at the back of the line, lost in the masses or forgotten by the powers that be, it's good to know that someone is coming to bring good news. And not only bring the news, but to celebrate with you in this good news. Jesus, by the way, was kind of known to be a bit of a party guy. I mean, really, think about it. We see him a lot, and he's very solemn, and he's very somber, and he's very quiet. But it wasn't unusual for him to get in trouble by the tightwads over at the church about it. The religious powers that be had issues with the crowds that he hung out with and the way he enjoyed life. Matthew 11 says that he came eating and drinking, and he did it so much that they called him a glutton. And worse, he was a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Tax collectors were no more loved then than they are now, I guess. He was accused of favoring the prostitute over the privileged. He preferred the beggar to the bestowed, and he chose the worn out over the well-to-do. His crowds looked a lot like the one that's gathered here this morning. Look, sometimes life's hard, and that makes it hard to laugh. But maybe if we could see the end of our problems, we'd feel a little more like smiling and laughing through them. Truth is, if we trust God, we trust that the one we've put our confidence in knows the beginning from the end.
Last year I went through a tornado. Have you ever been through a tornado? They sound like freight trains, don't they? Well, I'm from Texas, and I had never been through a tornado before, and I was on my houseboat. I have a houseboat, which is really just a trailer on floats. And about 2:30 in the morning, I woke up and heard a freight train coming down our lake. And I thought, there ain't no freight train on this lake. And it got closer and closer and closer and closer, and all of a sudden it hit, and it hit with a vengeance, and I didn't know what was going on, and all the lights were blown out on the dock, and the boat was bucking and rocking, and I was thrown to the floor, and on the way to the floor, I grabbed the curtains and looked outside, and lightning was flashing, and rain was flying sideways, and I thought, isn't that pretty? My ADD kicked in for just a second there. And then I realized, I'm gonna die. And I felt my way to the front of the boat, and it was still bucking and rocking, and I looked over at Pier 2, I'm on Pier 1, and I looked over at Pier 2, and the lightning flashed again, and I saw broken legs of the pier stretching into the sky, and I saw the bottoms of boats that had been flipped upside down, and I thought, oh, that can't be happening. You know, lightning flashes, and then it's gone, and you think, did I really see that? And it flashed again, and I thought, oh, I did see it. And I got on the radio, and I picked it up, and I said, are you guys there? Are you guys there? And this is Mark over on Pier 1. Are you okay on Pier 2? And after a few minutes, a few of them grabbed their radios. They said, yes, we're okay. We're upside down, but we're okay. And they'd all been through it before. Come to find out, this dock I'm on is called Tornado Alley. Of course, they didn't tell me that when I rented my space. And they'd all been through it before, and it scared the fool out of me. And I went up there the next morning to the coffee shop, and everybody drinks coffee and tells their fish tales. And I got some good fish tales. Of course, I've never fished in my life, but it don't stop you from having a good fish tale. And that morning, we had new tales to tell. And I said, you know what, y'all? I would have enjoyed that a lot more had I known I was going to live through it. Because it was fun. You know, I bet you when we get to heaven, well, I don't bet. Well, I could bet. I'm Baptist. We can bet. You Pentecostals, you bet you go straight to hell. I bet and go right to heaven. No, I bet you that when we get to heaven, you look me up and see if it ain't true. We're going to look back over our lives. And we're going to say, you know what? I'd have enjoyed that a lot more had I known I was going to live through it.
Kind of true, isn't it? A friend of mine told me once that he believed that the two most important gifts the human can receive are love and forgiveness. Nothing brings more joy or more laughter than those two things. The beginning of joy comes when we realize that the very special place we have in the heart of God is real. And maybe that begins with you this morning when you realize that there's a table set right here and there's a place at it for you. You get to eat, and there's nothing you can do that would cause God or us to rescind that invitation. Let's prepare to eat.
Thank you.
God, we thank you for the opportunity to come to your table. We thank you for laughter. We thank you for all of those things. We thank you for peace, and we thank you for hope, and we thank you for love, all of those things. But God, this morning, we especially thank you for joy. You give us joy. You make us smile. You make us happy. You make us laugh. Thank you for the invitation to come and eat. Thank you for the opportunity to break bread, to share a meal with our family this day. Thank you, Jesus, for your example, the example in how to live, how to be a good human, and how to treat others, how to be the best neighbor and the best brother, how to be the best friend. We thank you for all of the things that you've given us and all of those wonderful examples, and we thank you for the example that you left us when we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The night that Jesus gathered with his disciples, and many believe there were many, many others in the room that night, they gathered to have that meal together. It was a very eventful weekend, of course. This was pretty much the kickoff. Jesus was gathered with those who'd walked so many miles with him, and others from the community, and others from the neighborhood, and those who believed his words, but especially those who were attracted to his compassion. Because Jesus believed, and we believe, that everyone gets to eat. Everyone gets bread. Everyone gets wine. Everyone gets to enjoy God's bounty. So that night, with the disciples there together, he took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Take, eat." And I believe he probably went further and said, "Share. If you've got it, share it." So then he took the cup and he blessed the cup and he said, "Let's not forget what happens here in this place this night." They'd already washed feet. They'd already shown mutual love to one another, respect and admiration. So Jesus took the cup and he passed it around the table and he said, "Take. Drink." And I believe he said, "Share. Give it away. God gives freely. Go and give freely." So this morning, remember that as you enjoy communion. Marsha mentioned this morning that once you've received the elements and you've taken your communion, if you'd like, there's a flag there in the seat in front of you. If you didn't have a chance to do it earlier this week and you'd like to do it today or do it again even, you can make those notes and maybe prayer requests, wishes, hopes, whatever you want to write on the flag. And you can come and you can bring it and you can leave it with the other flags. And if you'd like, you can light a candle. But take, receive, in Jesus' name. Thank you. Just to let you know that feel free anytime through the remainder of the service, if you have a flag that you'd like to leave or a candle that you'd like to light, feel free to come during the offering, during the hymn, during the close of the service. It's not out of order at all. God, we thank you for the opportunity to share with others and to share with you what you've blessed us with. Take this that we bring this morning. Honor it, we pray in your name. Amen. Like to make everyone aware and let you know that after the service today, our assistant treasurer James, and I guess Bob, maybe you'll be back there too, James will have all of the giving statements for those of you who keep those things for tax records and use those. Those will be available after the service today. We'll be doing that for the next couple of Sundays, mm-hmm. I believe, and then after that, anyone who doesn't pick one up will get it in the mail to them, I assume. And all of those will be mailed to my house. I'll be happy to use those. Those will be available after service. Pastor Marsha, that's a pretty good job you did there this morning.
Pastor Kenny, yeah. That was a great job you did this morning.
You.
Thanks for reminding us to smile.
Thank you. It's always an honor. This is the first time that I've done this role, and you've actually been under the roof and sitting here. And when everybody else was smiling, you were just like... So I don't know if it took or not.
Well, John didn't pay much attention to me. I kept texting him going, cut it, cut it.
Thank you for the confidence that you've placed in me. I really, I sincerely, sincerely appreciate it. So thank you very much.
Pleasure is ours, isn't it, church? Pleasure is ours.
And thank all of you. Thank all of you. I hope you've been reminded that we do have a lot to smile about. There's a lot to get us down, but there's a lot to make us happy. There's a lot to smile about and laugh about. And can I tell you, I just got to tell you, I was up at 12:30, I guess 12:45 this morning, looking at YouTube videos of people laughing. And I'm telling you, it was tough going to sleep. I was sore. If you really want to spend a good 30 minutes or so enjoying life, get on YouTube and just Google.
Cute, Kenny. Cute.
Google contagious laughter. You can be there for a long time and really, 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 really enjoy life. This morning, if this seems like the kind of family you'd like to be a part of, we'd like nothing more than to open our arms and invite you in. We'll hold you and embrace you. We'll walk with you when you need extra help. We'll stand with you when you need extra encouragement. We'll pray with you when you need that support. We'll do everything we can to make you feel like you are a beautiful and valuable part of this family, because you are. You are. So this morning, as we sing our closing hymn, I'm the Light of the World, if you'd like to be a part of our family, I'd love to meet you right here, and we'll get that started. Peggy, are you coming this way to...
Well, I've already joined once, but I thought I'd join again because it was so much fun.
Let's sing our closing hymn. I'm the Light of the World.
I am the light of the world. You people come and follow me. Song of the angels is stilled when the star in the sky is gone, when the sages and the shepherds have found their way home, the work of Christmas is begun. In the light of the world, you people come and follow me. To
here's the challenge. You're going to leave here today blessed because you're blessed every day. But you're going to leave here today blessed and with a grin. And wherever you go, people are going to look at you and say, they're up to something. You wait and see. But let's go and be reminded that it really is okay. Even on a dark day, it really is okay to laugh. And that laugh may just be contagious. That'd make for a good world, wouldn't it? Let's go and do that.